day, everyone. Welcome. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the fourth webinar of an important webinar series designed to draw attention to the role of the higher education sector in Africa-Europe collaboration, and particularly in the context of the Africa-EU Strategic Partnership. This series was launched in response to the Africa-EU Summit that has taken place in February of this year. It is sponsored by the HAQUA initiative. HAQUA stands for Harmonization, Quality Assurance, and Accreditation of African Higher Education. It is a flagship initiative of the European Union in collaboration with the African Union. And it is co-implemented by Obriel Global, which is the organization that I represent. My name is Elizabeth Colucci, Director of Global Projects. The Association of African Universities. We have with us here today the Secretary General Olusola Oyewole, the German Academic Exchange Service, and the European Association for Quality Assurance in Higher Education. The webinar today is taking a closer look at the role of universities in research and innovation. The title of the webinar is University Research for Innovation, Resilience, and Poverty Reduction. We have a very dynamic panel of speakers, and we're also very pleased to be welcoming the European Commission DG Research here today with us. I would like to give you a few technical announcements before we get started. Please note that we have interpretation in three languages, in English, French, and Portuguese. You can activate the interpretation via the interpretation icon in the bottom of your screen and select the language you would like to listen to. We are in a webinar format here today. Unfortunately, we can't enable the audience members to speak, but we are very eager to hear from you. So please do put your comments in the chat or in the QA icon. If you have a specific question for a panelist, we encourage you to use the Q&A icon. That way those panelists can then answer you directly. And please do share with us. We are very eager to hear from you throughout the course of the event. Finally, I just wanted to let you know that we're recording today, and we will make the recordings available in three languages on the event website. Without further ado, I would like to pass the floor over to Olusola Oyewole, Secretary General of the Association of African Universities, important partner in this endeavor, to give a few welcoming words on behalf of the HAQUA initiative and AAU. And from there, I will pass the floor over to our chair, Olusola.
Yeah, thank you very much, Elizabeth Colucci. I want to welcome every one of us to this webinar, which is focused on the outcomes of the African EU Summit and the higher education sector. Our intention is to look at the implications, opportunities, and the next step forward following this summit. This is the fourth in the series of the webinars, and today's webinar is focused on university research for innovation, resilience, and poverty reduction. I want to welcome specially all our speakers and all the participants to this webinar. It is my pleasure to really welcome every one of you, and we look forward to a very exciting time of exchange of ideas. At this time, I will be handing over to Professor Martin from Sarua, who will be the chair of this particular webinar. Thank you very much.
Good morning, colleagues, and thank you very much, Prof. Olusola, for those words of welcome, also to Elizabeth, and welcome to all of you who are attending the webinar session today. And we're very pleased that we have such a strong set of panel members and participants who are speaking to us today about a very important issue and challenge. So the webinar is examining the high focus that the EU-Africa Summit in 2022 has placed on research capacity in Africa and strategic research partnerships between Africa and Europe. It will look in particular at African continental and Europe-Africa initiatives for research and innovation capacity building and will place special focus on how African research can be oriented towards resilience and poverty reduction. Just in terms of the setting the context for the webinar, if one notes the 2020 joint communication by the European Commission to the European Parliament and Council under the title of Towards a Comprehensive Strategy with Africa, that communication fairly early on states that there are 390 million people living below the poverty line on the African continent, and then makes various important observations about the fact that growth has not always been inclusive, partly due to governance issues, and also points to the multidimensional nature of poverty, pointing to climate change, environmental degradation and pollution, amongst other factors that impact on resilience and poverty reduction. And then emphasizes that the EU and Africa can work together to seize the opportunities that arise to meet these challenges, as well as to put in place actions that guarantee stability, peace, security, human rights, democracy, equality between men and women, sustainable livelihoods, and sustainable economic growth based on healthy ecosystems. And I think that this last sentence points to the range of factors that impact on poverty and resilience on the African continent. So poverty reduction and resilience must be addressed through a multidimensional approach. And this is also underscored by a speech by the UNDP resident representative in Africa at a research colloquium on multidimensional poverty in 2020, pointing to the fact that there are 1.3 billion people across 170 developing countries living in multidimensional poverty, and also to the fact that multidimensional poverty is a strong reality on the African continent. So I think there's no doubt that this webinar is extremely important and addresses a key challenge to sustainable development of on the African continent. Just a few words on Sorua. You will have access to the presentation, so I will not go into this in any detail, but Sorua was established in 2007 by the SADC Vice Chancellors. It has a range of objectives, focusing on developing a regional identity for higher education and collaborating and promoting partnerships and so on. And Sorua's vision and mission, you can see there. I won't read them out. You can read them and access them after the webinar. We are a membership-based organization, including both public and private higher education institutions, with a current membership of 50 universities throughout the SADC. And our focus areas are knowledge co-production, institutional quality management, digital transformation of higher education, and establishing an SADC Higher Education Academy. And our strategic enabler is developing a regional higher education database. I won't talk to the following two slides. You can access them after the webinar, but these slides just provide an overview of the various ways in which we are working together very closely with the SADC to support the SADC agenda for regional development. So onto the webinar theme for this morning, and you will see that the webinar will start with a presentation by Ms. Nienke Buysman. I hope I pronounced that correctly, the head of the unit F2 International Cooperation in the Directorate for General Research and Innovation at the European Commission, presenting on EU investment and funding initiatives, capacity building for African research. And then we have four distinguished panelists, Ms. Stella Amua from Arua, Ms. Rosemary Wilson from UJ, and also speaking today in her capacity as a member of the leadership of SARIMA, Professor Chomora Mikeka from the Education Ministry in Malawi, and then Prof. Marirajan Thirupathi from UNISA, Zambia. I will introduce each panelist when we get there, but at this point I would like to hand over to Ms. Ninka Boseman to continue with your presentation, please.
Yes, many thanks, Martin, and good morning to all. I'm very happy to be here with you this morning. Let me try to share my slides with you. Share. Okay, I hope you can all see my slides. What I'm going to do today, what I'm going to present to you today is the African Union, European Union Innovation Agenda that is that we are currently or already for months are working on together and which has been very much applauded in the summits that took place between our continents in February that you already presented. Indeed, in this summit, the role of research and innovation in our collaboration was underlined with a lot of importance. And out of it, we have decided that in our cooperation, there is a stronger need to focus on innovation. And I'm going to explain to you why. We have between the continents a long, very long lasting dialogue on research and innovation. It started already in 2010. And this is really a way for us to discuss together what we need to be doing together. But for the first time, 2 years ago, we had the ministers on both sides meet, the research and innovation ministers, together with Commissioner Gabriel on the EU side and the Commissioner on the African Union side, Commissioner Akbar, who was there at the time. And we discussed that over years, our collaboration between universities, research organizations, and the likes has mostly focused on research, on collaborative research in several areas, of course, in the area of food and nutrition security, public health, renewable energy, etc. But that we need to become much better at using these the results that come out of these collaborative projects, and really to find a way to enhance the translation of these endeavors into tangible businesses, products, services, and jobs. And this is exactly what this innovation agenda is about, and is now has become, since the summit, a flagship initiative of the Global Gateway Africa Europe Investment Package. Science, technology, and innovation is a flagship, and the innovation agenda is one of its priorities. So I'm going to explain a little bit to you how we are working hand in hand to make this happen. We're not there yet. We're in the middle of hopefully getting a very good program out of this. It involves this work, actually involves, of course, institutions on both sides, the European Commission, the African Union Commission, NEPAD also on the African Union side, and several of the member states. All of the member states are involved, and on both sides, of course, there are certain member states that are more actively involved, but also universities, higher education institutions, private sector, and other stakeholders, and I will come to that. So over the last years, we have mostly looked at a mapping of gaps and needs in our R&I collaboration, and based on that, have come up with this draft agenda that includes four objectives, and you see them on the screen, to translate the capacities into tangible outputs, to also work on the framework conditions to strengthen the innovation ecosystems, to create partnerships, to enhance partnerships, but most importantly also to build on what is already working and scale up those instruments and partnerships that are already working in this area. The agenda is set for a period of 10 years, and we have included short, medium, and long-term actions around the four priority pillars of our collaboration, which are R&I in public health, the green transition, where on one hand we have a focus on food and nutrition security and sustainable agriculture, and on the other hand on climate change and sustainable energy, innovation and technology and capacities for science. So here, this is just a little copy paste from the summit declaration that refers to the development of this joint innovation agenda. I think I've come to this already. The innovation agenda is entirely embedded in the policy context. I mean, at the start of this webinar, you were referred already to the EU comprehensive strategy with Africa, but there are, of course, many other strategies on both sides in which this new program is embedded. As I said, we are really working hand in hand to develop this this agenda and set up a working group that involves colleagues both from the African Union and from the European Union and the different stakeholders, as I said. I think this is a little bit a repetition of where I've come from, but really just to give you an overview again, that it's just not a, it's not a one-off thing, but we have been working already for months hand in hand to make this happen. This very importantly, I think, especially also for this webinar, is that we aim to involve all the innovation stakeholders. And it's not only a collaboration between institutions, such as the European and the African Union Commission. It involves the member states on both sides, higher education institutions, the public and private research institutions, startups, et cetera, and civil society organizations. And I'm going to give you an example of who has been involved in this in my next slides. Building, and this agenda is very much building on the long lasting 10, 20 years of collaboration that that already exists. And maybe I take a little bit of time of what this looks like. I've said that we really work around four priorities. These four priorities have been decided together in this regular policy dialogue that we have, and it was agreed at ministerial level in 2020. But of course, this doesn't come out of nowhere. We have very strong research partnerships in these four areas. For example, in the area of public health, an example that I would like to give that some of you may know is the European and Developing Countries Clinical Trials Partnership, EDCTP, that focuses and that just started its third phase of 10 years. It involves several partners on both sides that also come with their own budget, and it focuses on research in the area of infectious diseases, including clinical trials. In the green transition, we have two research partnerships, one in food and nutrition security, the other one in climate change and sustainable energy. And here again, it really is a program that was drawn to, these are two programs that were drawn up together. The research priorities were identified together, and it's also implemented together by researchers from both sides, and the budgets are coming from member states on both sides, as well as the European Commission. And this is actually the case for all of the four priorities that we have identified. We don't only agree on the priorities together, we also implement them together, and including the funding. So I think that, what I really would like to say is this, that this cooperation in research and innovation is a true partnership in our eyes. Okay, so let me now take...
Então, agora, vou falar bocadinho sobre como que consideramos o desenvolvimento das instituições do ensino superior na União Europeia e na União Africana, mas especialmente vou concentrar-me na União Africana, dessa parte na agenda de inovação que foi apresentada em fevereiro, por volta da Cimeira, e naquela Cimeira houve um fórum empresarial União Africana e União Europeia, e foi então que a agenda de inovação foi apresentada. Também lançamos uma consulta pública.
End of June. In this public consultation, it was actually online. We have received.
Nessa consulta pública recebemos mais de 50 contributos das instituições de ensino superior da África.
Countries, as well as contributions from the Europe and USA, and here. You see some of those. In addition, we have participated a bit, like today, and in several webinars that were organized around the continent, and extensive communication campaigns were organized, for example, by the Regional Universities Forum for Capacity Building in Agriculture, the RU Forum. We have also worked hand in hand with Arua, who is with us today, and on the European side, the Guild of European Research in Intensive Universities. In November this year, we are organizing a big stakeholder event that will take place at the end of November in Nairobi. Where we will be inviting many of the stakeholders that have participated already in the public consultation, but also additional ones that are maybe not yet on our radar screen. And this stakeholder event will be about, first of all, presenting what we have received as input from the stakeholders on the innovation agenda, how we believe we may integrate it in an updated version of the agenda. But around this stakeholder event, there will be a lot of time for discussions, training workshops, pitching events, etc. So the dates we have on our agenda now are the 23rd and the 24th of November in Nairobi, and we will soon start public communication around this. So we see a key role of higher education institutions, universities in executing the implementation, coordinating and facilitating the different actions of this innovation agenda. And here you have a very nice overview, I think, of some of the logos of some of the African institutions that have very nicely contributed to this public consultation that has been open online for several months. And here, another set of European and American institutions that contributed to the public consultation. So you see it's very wide ranging. Of course, there are always many that are missing. And I think one of the questions that we will address also later is how do you actually reach out and can involve those who are maybe not, let's say, the usual suspect or the organizations that we that are actively involved in the cooperation, and I'm looking forward to also hearing some of the ideas on this. So here, just because the slides will also be shared with you, you have an overview of the short, medium, and long-term actions that we have at the moment in the innovation agenda. And you can see that also within these actions, there is very strong scope for capacity building and the involvement of all the actors. It's really this partnership and supporting the entire innovation ecosystem between universities, private sector, government, and NGO that this agenda will address. So in the short term, for example, we will be supporting, for example, the networking of these platforms. Very importantly, always to remember that we don't start from scratch. We will build on existing projects, existing initiatives. And if you look at the working document of the agenda, the annex of it, you can see the mapping of all the initiatives that that exist. Of course, several of those are supported by the European Commission, either through the framework program, Horizon, the previous Horizon 2020, the current Horizon Europe, or Erasmus Plus, and several also of the programs funded by DG International Partnerships. So this is another dimension, let's say maybe more European Commission specific, is that it involves several DGs. We closely speak to each other. It involves several of our programs that address often, of course, different needs, whereby, for example, we could say that the Horizon program is rather competitive, having access or being successful in submitting a proposal is not that straightforward, this can be prepared by more capacity building oriented programs that are being managed by DG International Partnership. So it is really trying also in the EU on the EU side to enhance the synergies between our different instruments. So I will not go through all these short term actions, but all the actions, but you can see they are classified by priority and by short-term, medium-term, and long-term actions. So maybe to finish off my presentation, here a little overview of the public consultation and stakeholder dialogue. The online public consultation has finished. We're in the middle of looking at all the replies received. We've received over 300 contributions. And this will be summarized and communicated in a dedicated report and then discussed at our stakeholder event in Nairobi in November. We will also be organizing a roundtable discussion at the UNGA 77 Science Summit, where the purpose is to start to discuss or continue the discussion with the development banks and international cooperation financing institutions as one of the partners in this program. And here are some of the next steps that I've already shared with you, but it gives you a good overview of where we are going. Next big event is this stakeholder event, and we hope to see some of you there, after which on the institutional side will be finalizing the roadmap, hopefully for approval by our ministers in the first quarter of 2023. And when this all is adopted in parallel, of course, on the EU side, we are preparing our new programs, the new work program for Horizon Europe, the funding also from Global Europe and the key program. And this should this will be aimed at supporting the implementation of this agenda. So here are some acknowledgements of the organizations that are involved in this exercise. And I think I'm there. Thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer any questions I see. There are many, perhaps in the chat and the Q&A. I will have a look. Thank you very much. Then I hand back over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ninka, if I may use your first name, for that very informative presentation. We are slightly pressed for time, but if there is somebody or one or two people who would like to ask questions at this point, you're welcome to do so. I'm not sure if I can see all the participants, but if there are any questions, I've been following in the Q&A chat. I've not seen any questions in the Q&A chat. So it may be that there aren't specific questions at this point, and that we can continue. I've not seen any questions yet. I have seen some requests to be able to still participate in the consultation, but I understand that that is now actually closed. The online consultation is now closed.
We have still allowed for some participations lately. So I would suggest that whoever would like to still participate, they can contact me, and we can then be in touch bilaterally. I'll put my email in the chat.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. And then I saw there was one question about the asking for more details on the role of the academic staff in the universities. So I'm not sure if that's something that you would like to address now or.
But I don't see the question myself, so I'm not entirely sure whether within this phase where we have gone through now at a public consultation, it varies. In certain cases, it really is individuals within the university that have participated. In other cases, universities have decided to contribute, let's say, in a coordinated fashion. So one answer for the university, perhaps, where there have been internal discussions. So in the future as well, I guess it will be. And I'm not really able to give any examples for the moment. So it probably, depends a little bit on it's always individuals, no, within the universities who are involved in this type of work.
Thank you.
Thank you very
much. Thank you so much. We will continue now with the panel discussions. So we have the four panelists. I've already indicated who they are. I will ask the panel members to please try to stick to your 10 minutes. I'm not quite sure how in the webinar one sends out an alert that you have 1 minute left, but I'll just, I might send you just a message to say that you have 1 or 2 minutes left for your presentation. I do want to say that we will then, after the panel presentations, we will have an opportunity for a panel discussion to address two questions. I'll put them up for you when we get to that point. But we will also be following up with everyone who is attending today with a follow-up survey to ask you to respond to the panel discussions so that we can gauge how we can take today's very important discussion forward and explore further ways in which we can promote collaboration around today's theme. So our first panelist is Mrs. Stella Amua from ARUA, the network manager for ARUA, the African Research Universities Alliance. She assumed this position in April 2022. She is an accredited PR practitioner, holds a master's degree in communications, as well as a master's degree from the Legon Center for International Affairs and Diplomacy. And Mrs. Amua recently retired as the Director of Public Affairs at the University of Ghana, having worked with that university for almost 20 years. So Mrs. Amua, Stella, I have pleasure in handing over the floor to you.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to say a big thank you to the organizers for inviting Arua to be part of this webinar. For those who may not know Arua, the African Research Universities Alliance, was inaugurated in Dakar in March 2015 and is a network of universities from different countries and from different historical backgrounds in Africa, but with a common vision. Currently, Arua brings together 16 of the region's leading universities. So with that introduction, I'd like to say thank you also again to the organizers, and I will begin my presentation. I think I shared it with Elizabeth. I don't know whether you would share it so that I can go through the presentation.
Yes, indeed, we can share it for you if you prefer. Just one moment, we'll pull it up. Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry, Elizabeth, if I had to put you on the spot, I thought...
No, that's okay, not a problem. Just one moment, it's just opening, and I will share my screen. Sorry for the delay, just a little slow.
Start.
Sorry, just one more moment. It's just loading.
Okay. Well, as Elizabeth shares, probably I'll start so that I do not eat into the time. Arua's vision and mission. We, as Arua, have a mission to make African researchers and institutions globally competitive while contributing to the generation of knowledge for socioeconomic transformation in Africa. And our mission, that's the second slide, our mission is to strengthen African universities through effective capacity building that comes from working together as leading institutions to increase research output. And I think that this is what Africa needs from its leading universities, making researchers in African institutions globally competitive, because we live in the global world, so that we can contribute to knowledge dissemination for our socioeconomic transformation, and also to strengthen our universities through the effective capacity building that comes from us coming together to increase research output. Next slide, please. So this slide, the next slide, is just to give you an overview of Arua's geographic footprint. We have 16 universities. On the next slide, you would see 16 member universities. University of Mauritius is the only associate member, but the other 15 are full members of Arua, and they come from Ethiopia, Ghana, Kenya, Nigeria, Rwanda, Senegal, South Africa, Tanzania, Uganda, and Mauritius. So we have the Addis Ababa University. In Ghana, we have the University of Ghana. In Kenya, University of Nairobi. Nigeria, we have two, that's the University of Ibadan and the University of Lagos. In Rwanda, University of Rwanda, and we have the UCAD in Senegal. And in South Africa, we have six universities: Rhodes, Stellenbosch, UCT, University of KwaZulu-Natal, University of Pretoria, and WITS. In Tanzania, we have University of Dar es Salaam, and then Makerere University from Uganda, and finally, University of Mauritius. So those are the geographic footprint of Arua. Of course, we also have our value proposition. About a month ago, Arua launched its 5-year strategic plan in Accra. And so as member universities, what the Alliance is looking at is how we partner and how we collaborate with each other. And we leverage our resources and capability to make the Alliance strong. So what are the things that we would like to see Arua in action? And those are the 4 thematic areas of advocacy and leverage, institutional capability for research management, enhanced graduate support and training, and enhanced research. So those are the 4 generalized or thematic areas that Arua is focusing on, especially with its strategic plan recently launched. What outcomes are we looking for? Please, the slide before. The outcomes is to advocate for funding and then also to increase Africa's global cutting-edge research. And then we also want to look at 10 African universities in the global top 200, that is the rankings. And then we also want to see 75% of faculty who have PhDs in member universities. And not just the quantity, but also we want to look at quality. And that is why we want good quality PhD graduates for other universities as well, to build strong links with industry and other sectors, and ultimately build what Arua calls the African University. So on our next slide, how are we working towards that? Currently, Arua has 13 centers of excellence in member universities. Our conceptualization of our centers of excellence, we have focal points for aggregating world-class researchers from member universities to undertake the collaborative research in our priority thematic areas, the 4 that I have mentioned earlier. And our structure is a structure of the centers of excellence. We have the hub and then we have the spoke model. So I'll come to explain that later when I look at, I zero in on one of the centers of excellence. So the hub is the host institution or university, and then the spoke are other universities who have these expertise that we put to action in the centers of excellence. And then the scope of work is capacity building, as I've said, and research excellence related to the SDGs. Next slide, please. So as I said, we have 13 centers of excellence from the natural sciences and then the social sciences as they are listed. So we have natural sciences, we have climate change, sustainable food systems, NCDs, materials, energy and nanotechnology, energy and water conservation on the side of the natural sciences. And for social sciences, we have 7, which I have listed: migration and mobility, poverty and inequality, unemployment and skills development, notions of identity, good governance, post-conflict societies, urbanization and habitable cities. So we will zero in on the poverty and inequality, but just to say that we are seeking to increase these centers of excellence to 40 in new areas, such as public health, the blue economy and energy transitions, the Green Deal, digital transformations for a more sustainable economy and society, good governance, peace and security, and overcoming discrimination. So we intend to increase these from 13 to 40 in the long term, medium to long term. So what are the main tasks of the centers of excellence? But as I said, I zero in on the poverty and inequality. Our center of excellence in poverty and inequality, the center hub is located at the University of Cape Town. And we have the spoke models. We have the spoke for Western Africa. It's at the University of Ghana. For Eastern Africa, we have it at the University of Nairobi, and the hub university itself, University of Cape Town, we have the Southern Africa node. Their main task is to use census and survey data to profile and map inequality and poverty. Also to describe and analyze contemporary inequality using household surveys, to analyze the dynamics of poverty and inequality using panel data, and using these as a platform for dialogue on strategies to overcome poverty and inequality. So these are the main tasks of the centers of excellence, and zeroing on poverty and inequality, this is what they would do. I've also explained the structure. And so I think we can go on to the next slide. But in anything that we do, there are challenges. And some of the challenges we have identified is that there are gaps in data for most African countries. And that brings out the reason for continuous research and using experts. And then with COVID, we also realized that there was a lot of changes in working conditions and working from home, and then spaces not available and all that. But besides the challenges, we know that what has made the centers of excellence successful is what I described earlier, the hub and the spoke model, because you're bringing together, you're using experts in all these regions to come together to, if you will, strengthen the centers of excellence. And to, and also, it also gives an opportunity. To dialogue with fellow academics in the sub-region and experts. We've learned also some lessons that we cannot afford to work in isolation. A collaborative and partnership approach is what is needed to take us to our shared vision and our shared goals, and then prioritizing our common challenges and making a lasting impact. I think the final slide is where I talk about the ARUA and the Guild. We know we cannot work in isolation. So besides working on the continent, we also have a relationship with the Guild of Universities, and we realize the critical importance of strengthening African universities. And to this, ARUA and the Guild issued a joint call to invest in clusters of excellence at African research universities and strengthen the African research, innovation, and higher education systems, foster a critical debate and reflection, and then also develop what the two of us call a matching fund approach. So both ARUA and the Guild welcome the concrete agenda, as well as the emphasis on aspects of our joint call. That ends my presentation, and I thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Stella, for that very informative presentation. I've been watching the chat function, and remark that I've seen is a remark about the place of languages, and you know, to what the extent to which language is part of our focus when we want to work on the SDGs. So I don't know if you want to just briefly respond to that observation, Stella.
Yes,
That is languages.
Yeah, just on the role of languages and, you know, sort of what role they play in working together around the SDGs.
Well, it's been a concern of ARUA, where currently we have only one Francophone country, that is Senegal. And we are looking to inviting, even as our members increase, we are looking to inviting more or additional member universities on the Francophone side. Definitely language will be a challenge, but it is not impossible to cross that barrier.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, Stella. Colleagues, we then move on to the next presenter. This is Rosemary Wilson from the University of Johannesburg, where she is the director of the University's Technology Transfer Office. Also speaking today in her capacity as the Vice President for Innovation and Technology Transfer of SORIMA, the Southern African Research and Innovation Management Association. I'm not going to read the whole bio. You can find this on the recording and on the of the meeting. But I thought perhaps the very last statement is important, Rosemary. She is passionate about innovation and its potential to change lives for the better, which I found really great. Rosemary has worked at the CSIR as a senior intellectual property manager, at UCT before that, in establishing a new technology transfer office and developing the research contract management function, and also at UCT as a researcher in the Science and Technology Policy Research Center. And Rosemary holds a BSc honors in microbiology and NLB, and an MPhil all from UCT. So Rosemary, with that short introduction, I will hand over to you. Thank you. Rosemary, sorry, you are
still muted. It's been lovely to watch all the comments in the chat and to see how much ground we covered in representation of different areas. So thanks for the opportunity. Hopefully you can see my screen now. Let's try to start the slideshow. So this morning, I'd just like to briefly introduce you to SORIMA, the Southern African Research and Innovation Management Association. We occupy a particular niche in supporting a lot of the activities that we've already heard about this morning. SORIMA was established in 2002, so this year we mark our 20-year anniversary. And it's a platform for research and innovation management practitioners in both public and private sector. So our membership aims at research and innovation managers, technology transfer practitioners, as well as researchers who often play quite a big role in managing their research, and project managers. We're a membership-based organization. And we aim to promote and facilitate best practices in research and innovation management, and to strengthen the research and innovation management system to support regional, social, and economic development. So our stakeholders are broad, as well as practitioners. We work with and have members from all types of organizations, including government agencies, IP law firms, universities, and other research organizations, investors, venture capital, accelerators, and incubators. Our vision is to be the forum of choice for professionals in research and innovation management because of our distinct ability to influence, educate, advocate, and innovate on behalf of the profession. Our mission is to support the research endeavor in Southern Africa. Our focus is generally the SADC countries. There are some sister organizations in East and West Africa, but I will also add that as CEREMA, we partner a lot with other organizations in other parts of Africa and around the world. Our strategic objectives are to pioneer professional excellence, advocate with an authentic voice, ensure engagement and connectivity, cultivate communities of practice, and realize sustainability and resilience, both as an organization and amongst our members and the societies we're embedded in. This slide gives a very broad brushstroke of what we do. So we carry out, we hold conferences, including an annual conference, and I'll give a little bit of information about that. We run training, and we have a now quite a substantial library of training courses. We run both live training and some online courses. Since the pandemic, we've run pretty much all our courses online, including the live courses. And we'll see to what extent that might change now that things are hopefully normalizing. But yeah, generally, these are short courses of about between 1 to 3 days on basic topics, as well as some more specialized topics. We run various network exchange and mentorship programs. And we have an advocacy role where there are policy issues, for example, new legislation that requires a collective response from members. And also in terms of growing awareness of the importance of research and innovation management at institutional level, and then also at national and regional level. So raising awareness of the benefits of this. As outputs, we build capacity, we develop communities of practice. One of our very active ones at the moment is for research ethics. We are also exploring a new one on valorization from social sciences, arts and humanities. And we also would like to see ourselves as role models, particularly drawing on the experience of those who've been in the profession for a while to help mentor and facilitate new officers and mentor emerging professionals and practitioners. We provide for professional accreditation. There are two, one on the research management side and one on the innovation and technology transfer side. These are international credentials, and we work hard at creating a conducive research and innovation management climate through our advocacy roles, and ultimately ensure that we have a cohort of enhanced of managers with enhanced skills and expertise. The aim of all of this ultimately is to ensure that our research institutions are able to perform efficient and impactful research, leading to new products and services and building our societies and economies. A lot of this we do through different projects. There isn't time to go through the projects in any level of detail. But I think this gives a little flavor. Say we partner with a wide range of organizations. We have with many represented here today. One project I'll just highlight is our SRIM project, Strengthening Research and Innovation Management in SADC, which is the second phase of a project that's getting underway at the moment, where we are looking at establishing national focal points as well as CEREMA contact points in each of our countries of interest, and providing resources, training, and holding country symposia, also responding to specific needs in different countries to build the profession, particularly outside South Africa. In terms of SWIMA membership benefits, I'll have a little ad here. You know, you get a discount on SWIMA events, access to SWIMA's network of partners, facilitators and trainers and resources, specialized courses. We offer a number of open courses each year, but also do quite a lot of in-house training and bespoke training where there are particular needs for particular organization or stakeholders. So for example, in one country through a national capacity development organization. We've held training that they have made open to all institutions in the country. We give access to a number of international opportunities, such as mobility exchanges, mentorship and funding, including some that we've offered that have come through the EU in the past. Access to information, including measuring, monitoring and evaluation. Access to training material that can be customized. We have a lot of open access resources that you can find on our website. Access to community of best practices and the opportunity for professionalization through those international accreditation credentials that I mentioned in both the research management side and the innovation side of things. I'd like to alert you of SWIMA's upcoming annual conference that's going to be held in Johannesburg in 2 weeks' time. It will be held on a hybrid model, so it's also possible to attend as online. And then also to mention next year in 2023, SWIMA will be hosting the iNorms conference. iNorms is an international association of associations of which SWIMA is a member for research management professionals. And the conference is held by different member organizations. And next year it will be held and co-hosted by SWIMA in Durban, South Africa. And abstract submission is open. So I'd also like to encourage people to consider both conferences. Little bit of information on our website if you're interested in membership or the website just to see the resources and activities and training that we have available. Thanks very much.
Thank you. So much, Rosemary, for that very informative presentation. I am noting one or two questions which are coming through. I'm also noting that we are going over time, and that's unfortunately, I think just the fact that the webinar is so full. So with your indulgence, we will either have to make a decision after the next two presentations about whether we actually address the two panel questions now, or perhaps say, let's address those two questions in a follow-up webinar when we've also received inputs from the participants today, which I would suggest might be the best approach because we don't want to cut that important discussion short. And perhaps as well, when we do a follow-up webinar, some of the questions that are coming through, I think, are important. One question is about whether the four focus areas or priority areas whether that is all that is on the table, or whether there's an opportunity to also look at a greater contribution from the social sciences and humanities. I think that's a question that we need to address perhaps in a follow-up webinar. I am a humanities person, so for me, it's always very important to realize the intersectionality of various disciplines in addressing big societal challenges. And another important question I think that we do need to put on the table is how we can, in a sense, bring, or the role that Arua is playing to bring funders together to improve the sources of pooled funds for research and innovation. If there's time today, we could address that question to Arua and perhaps Prof. Olusola or Stella might want to address that question today, or otherwise we can hold it over until a follow-up meeting. So there's also a question about whether Arua membership is for a closed group only by invitation, or, and then the question stopped. So I assume it would be a question about whether universities may apply for membership. Again, perhaps that's something that we can address after the two other panelists have presented. So I'm going to continue with the inviting our third panelist. You'll note, colleagues, that we are sort of taking each panel member is giving us a narrower focus. So we began with the African continent, then with Sorimo working in SADC. Now we move to a specific country, Malawi. And Professor Chomora Mikeka is the Director of Science, Technology and Innovation in the Ministry of Education of the Malawi Government, and Associate Professor of Physics at Chancellor College of the University of Malawi. He holds a doctorate in engineering from the Division of Physics, Electrical and Computer Engineering at Yokohama National University in Japan, and is the chairperson of the African Standards Organization for Medical Devices, the National Commission for Science and Technology, Pharmacy Medicines and Regulatory Authority, and the Southern African Development Community Regional Medical Devices Forum Technical Working Group. I met Prof. Chomora recently at the SADC Ministers of Education, Training and Science, Technology and Innovation. Great privilege to have met you, Prof. Chomora, and also to now hand over the floor to you. Thank you. Prof. Chomora, you should just unmute.
Yes, thank you. I have unmuted, and then I just want to go to the first.
Fine, sorry.
Thank you for the opportunity, Martin, but also for the past presentations by Nienke Bisman from EU-AU on that, but also Stella Moa, Arua, also Rosemary from Sarima. I think I last interacted with Sarima in 2012 when I just returned from Japan. So this is an exciting presentation and involvement. I'll give a national context.
Yes, it's limited. Hello, can you unmute Mr. Chomora? You're muted.
Prof. Chomora, you are muted.
No, I am unmuted from here.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay. My apologies. So yes, So this is the flow, basically. And then we also highlight the aspects of measurements of science, technology, and innovation, but also a measurement of researchers. So the researchers must be measured so that their research is seen to be of impact. In the National Development Blueprint for Malawi, there is specifically on page 69, as I show there, that the nation demands that research is conducted jointly with higher education institutions, including PhD students and industry players, to catalyze private investment. So the National Commission is placed in there. There are timelines. This is just to show that within the National Development Blueprint, we value research highly, as shown in there. This was launched last year by the President, His Excellency Dr. Lazarus McCarthy Chakwera, and it is an agenda until 2030 to cascade, or also to map underline to the SDGs 2030, but also other specific instruments and frameworks within the region. And also, when you look at the National Development Agenda, we find that we do keyword search. Science appears a couple of times, technology, innovation, GDP, laws. And this shows that science, technology, and innovation, including research, has a dimension to play to motivate economic development. And this was seen when we did some studies and research, desk research, that more inputs which are given financially to steer economic growth can only do so up to 27%. But if we bring in innovation, or invest in innovation, then obviously that is possible to turn around economic growth or stay it up to 63% plus. In other words, we need to insist and invest in terms of research and innovation to eradicate or reduce poverty, as is being seen mentioned here, but also promote economic growth. This is a proof fact. Basically, with the commission that we have on science, technology, and innovation, there is a policy 2002, which is 20 years old, but also an act which is 2003, 19 years old. In here, as you can see on the chart, there is several sectors which conduct research based on the committees which are in there. Then there is the last one, which is in the University Science and Technology Committee. So it was conceptualized in 20 years ago that each university within Malawi should be able to have a science and technology committee to promote research, social and scientific and all other kind of research, but also to make sure that also motivates development. So this is the structure which is provided for on the last page of the Malawi Science and Technology Policy, which now is being reviewed. If we look at the act itself, you find that part C and part E talks of source of funding from within Malawi and also externally to promote national research and development. And similarly, part E is to appraise, review, and monitor the outcomes or outputs of research based on the provisions which are in there. So in terms of legislation, policy, the context is very clear, and that's the act which provides for this. However, what was seen recently is that if we read the policy, the act, the innovation, the I was not paramount, and therefore it was important to define the I, which is innovation, but also consistently aligned to the national, regional, continental, and global frameworks, which are promoting now the two-legged science, technology, and innovation. So that three-dimensional structure. And the government has approved establishment of the National Science, Technology, and Innovation Technical Working Group, and also has approved with partial funding to do a science, technology, and innovation policy, hoping that with the players, other players, we should be able to mobilize more resources to work and finalize this within 12 months. And I think there we're inviting for more partners. In this kind of Rotman Reins diagrammatic view or model, we constitute a vortex where multiple players, the commission, the national planning, schools, universities, and all those government development partners and industry players or private sector and international cooperating partners coming together in a hub and spoke model, as was highlighted later earlier on by Stella. So you see that different players are coming around there and they have needs and they have offers into the vortex. So the vortex will be a flow of power, the innovation space where things are happening to solve problems as they come together. So that's one dimension and approach that is already working. In there, the co-chairship is between the government itself, my directorate, Minister of Education, and a development partner, United Nations Development Program, UNDP, is co-chairing. And I think this is consistent with what UNDP Resident Representative for Africa observed earlier on, as was highlighted by Martin and other presenters. I think Nyenke did that. We observe that in science, technology, and innovation, science is measured by publications, technology by patents as an application of the knowledge generated in science, and innovation is seen based on the developments, seen creative goods and services. This is very important for us because in Africa, we have seen a promotion of science where more publications have been produced, but less of use of the application for development, and therefore the impact on the community or poverty reduction and related aspects has not been seen, particularly in the communities we have seen. And that's why I appreciate the previous speakers who highlighted low tech to high tech and through innovation. And this is very important to be seen. So we put their publications on new knowledge, patents on new technologies, and obviously measure innovation based on specific available frameworks. As I'll be concluding, I wanted to highlight that the African SADC region, the region in which we are, has selected 40 value chains. Out of these 40 value chains, Malawi has super selected 22, which we see as being an opportunity to exploit fully, to innovate, reduce poverty, and also, bring some level of household resilience to the citizens. So you will see in this paper, I highlighted number 5 here, the value chain of fish. Then there is a researcher from University of Malawi through the Google Scholar, were able to capture their paper, household resilience among fish, players. This is important and it's very relevant. You are targeting a value chain to make sure that we are able to respond to the needs. We are also promoting other work, for example, in energy, sustainable energy, using innovative approaches. This is my own capture of papers which are available in the Google Scholar. Then we are requesting universities to make sure that their programs align to the value chains, but also centers of excellence and centers of specializations which are proposed or established by universities must also align to the value chain so that there's full exploitation of those ones and relevance to solve the problems which we are currently experiencing. I have summarized some of the specific needs, for example, in our case, advanced materials, energy storage, then the 3D, 4D printing, computing, and related aspects. These are some of the things which universities can deliberately choose and say that we would like to focus on this. To make sure that innovation works, we need to create spaces within the universities. And therefore our National Development Blueprint has already highlighted need for fabrication lab, maker spaces, innovation hubs, garages, technology parks, in the higher education institutions. And this is from last year to 2025. So therefore we are pulling all the donors, development partners, international cooperating partners to come and specifically finance these kind of things, to make sure that innovation is of value. What are the key takeaways? This is my last slide now. The key takeaways is number one, that we have a national development blueprint, which defines the strategies, priority interventions for research and science, technology, and innovation. I think this is the same space which I've seen by EUAU. Policy and registration on science and technology, it does exist, but it is old, 20 years, 2 decades, and must be revised. And we are calling upon multiple players to join with us. Government has already committed $10,000 towards that, so that at least is it 10,000 or is it 100,000? 100 million Malawi kwacha divided by 1,000. So yeah, it's available for towards working on the policy revision, but also to establish the new science technology policy. Then there is the hub and spoke model, where we are building a nexus of science, technology, and innovation technical working group nationally to bring all the players which we have seen together so that at least we can address issues of innovation, poverty reduction, and economic growth. Lastly, measuring the researcher through specific global indices available. For example, H index, but also I10 index. Most of the researchers have published, but their papers have not been cited. And the question is that work of relevance, of impact, is it solving our specific problems? And therefore, we need to define how to measure research outputs and how to measure them appropriately so that we drive investment where it matters most. I think this one would be my last slide in the respect of time, just to spur and provoke discussion. Thank you. Thank you, Martin.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Prof. Chamora. I think for a very, very important perspective on from a national perspective, how the challenges of SDI policy are being addressed in Malawi. So, and I think, you know, you've emphasized as well the importance of really bringing together the work of the universities in the national system so that they can play an integrated role in science, technology, and innovation. I will now move on to our last presenter, our fourth presenter, Professor Mari Rajan Thirupathi, who is currently the Deputy Vice Chancellor for Research and Innovation at UNICEF University in Zambia, who holds an interdisciplinary PhD in Community Governance and Resource Management. He's working in Africa in various capacities, teaching physical, blended, and online graduate courses in sociology, social work, and educational administration. And his current research focuses on ecosystem approaches, sustainable livelihoods, sustainable farming, climate resilience, socioeconomics, monitoring, and governance. I won't go further, but to hand over the floor to you, Professor Mari Rajan. Thank you.
I hope you hear my voice.
I can hear you now, thank you.
Yes. Yeah, okay. Thank you very much, Martin, for the brief introduction. I'm representing UNICEF University. With the seminar, with the webinar context, I'm going to present from our own experience, the case study about UNICEF University, how it is involving in research and innovation activity. That's the part I'm going to cover for this webinar. UNICEF University is one of the registered private university in Zambia from 2017, as per Higher Education Act 2013. It is one of the leading online university offering locally and internationally accredited program from bachelor's to PhD, with the motto of increasing access to quality higher education to African continent. It almost 8 African countries. We have universities and also branches to covering as a pan-African university. We were committed to developing research and innovation and the entrepreneurship ecosystem by contributing to the national agenda, especially in Zambian context. We were trying to address the issues mentioned in Vision 2030 document and also to contributing to the SDG outcomes. This is our main motto to build a research and innovation center. This research and innovation centers registered under National Science and Technology. We certain areas we were covering based on the guidance from National Science and Technology through our research and innovations. We also have the Research Ethics Committee, It's an institutional ethics committee which gives ethical clearance to our students' research. It also, this ethics committee registered with National Health Research Authority for capacity building as well as the training workshops for our own researcher as well as for our students. We were cooperating with the National NHRE, National Health Research Ethics Committee. In this background,
I'm sorry to interrupt you. There's a request. Could you try to switch to the slideshow mode for your presentation to present so that the presentation will present in the slideshow mode?
Okay.
If you could try that, thank you.
Is it okay now?
Yes.
100%. Thank you.
Okay. The UNICAF have developed research strategies. This strategy is going on from 2022 to 2026. So there are four research strategic areas. We already set it out. The first one, we mainly focusing on clusters, establishing research clusters. Each of the cluster is going to be anchored with the PhD programs. It's not just on a PhD program. Each clusters have their own PhD programs that motivate both staffs and students to do research activity based on the cluster themes. So we have education for development, and also we have global change and sustainability, then financial inclusion and innovations, then alternative knowledge systems and health remedies. These are all the four clusters we have. These clusters were developed based on our national development plans as well as our country's long-term visions. And also these clusters were serving the faculties we are having. So under these clusters, currently we have three research activities. Mainly the cluster number two, it gives the global change on sustainability. Under this cluster, we currently the self-funded research activities, it's going on, that is called experimental research study on exploring the potentials of producing bioethanol from SEMA waste. SEMA waste is one of the biggest issue in cities like Lusaka. How to, most of the waste produced from SEMA, it is illegally disposing the SEMA waste is one of the issue faced by the urban the governance systems, especially the cities they are facing struggle to how to set it out this issue. So our focus is to develop certain innovative mechanism to address this issue. So we came up with innovative project called producing bioethanol from SEMA waste. We developed bioreactor. This bioreactor is going to be utilized to generate bioethanol from SEMA waste. This idea, this bioreactor is registered with the PACRA as an innovation product. Initial patenting was done with the PACRA for bioreactors. So currently the experiment is going on to generate ethanol from SEMA waste. Still it is in trial process, but maybe in another 6 months time, we can able to come up with how much ethanol you can able to produce from SEMA waste. So this is one of the innovative idea is currently patented with the PACRA. Now the trials are going on. The second one, dementia training and research. In association with Hatterfield University, it is one of our research partnership university. We initiating a training project. It was started as a training project. Currently, it is going on a research as well. So we are trying to identify, documenting, and evaluating the challenges to implement the focused intervention training and support in relation to dementia program. Dementia cases were very common in Zambia. People were thinking that it is because of the witchcraft. But we were trying to address this issue through a community sensitization program, as well as training the medical practitioners. We were in collaboration with the level one hospital to train the medical practitioner to deal dementia cases. So the Hatterfield University gave training to the health practitioners, especially under the title of dementia coaches. We train in through our first phases. Now we are in the second phase of doing a research. So the third one, we ourselves through self-funded mode, we were initiating to study the effects of COVID-19 on the academic performances of Zambian students in public and private universities, how the COVID is affecting the academic performance, especially those who are involved in online learning. It is one of our major focus area. So we were trying to understand the academic performance in relation to COVID-19. So all these three efforts were directly relevant to our thematic area. We were trying to motivate our staffs as well as students to focus on this area, either in the form of research or in the form of innovation products. Now I'm moving to strategic area number two. This strategic area, we were trying to disseminate the activities, what we are doing under strategic area one. We are trying to disseminate the research output of our faculties and staffs through either in the publication of journals or through conferences. We were trying to disseminate the research outputs. So we already organized consultative sessions on humanizing the workplace report along with the GOLD, a Zimbabwe-based organization. We were came up with the chain of webinar to understand how we can able to humanize our workplaces. We conducted a chain of webinars, then we came up with a report. This report was shared with the organizations, those who are trying to humanize their workplaces. Then currently, in association with the Research Culture Society India, we were organizing an international conference, which is going to be held on 13th and 14th August 2022 at Thailand. Then another one is we planned. This one is an online event. The third one, it is about Spaces for the Future conference in September 2022. It is going to be a physical conference in Zambia. It is the international conference and summer schools we are organizing along with the Lübeck University, Germany. It is going to be happen physically in Zambia. The third strategic area, we are trying to create and enable research, innovation, entrepreneurship ecosystem within the university environments. So we were organizing active research dialogues and also the forums among our staff members and students. It's a continuous effort to motivate our team and also our students to engage productive research. The fourth strategic focus as an institution, we were trying to continuously developing and strengthening research capacity, productivity, and impact by optimally mobilizing the funds for our trainings and collaboration and partnerships. So far, there are four research collaborations we have. The first one, Center for Environmental Justice, action research-based organizations at the grassroots level. We were trying to do environmental dialogues among school students through these organizations. It is going to be for next 5 years through CEJ. We were going with the pilot projects and dialogues we were doing through the grassroots organizations. Then the COLD, through this Zimbabwean partnerships, we were engaging visiting scholars and practitioners and students' interactions and the action research we were already doing. Then with the support of Levi Manawasa Universities, we were trying to applying some joint projects, especially for health-related research. Then Hutterfield, it is one of the prominent UK-based partnership. It is already in establishing some trainings and research projects. It is going to be for next 3 years. This is what as an individual university, how we can able to support our national government as well as to support SDG agenda as an individual university through research and innovation activity. That's all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Prof. Marie Rajan, for that informative presentation. Also on the way that the UNICEF University is contributing to national development priorities. So, colleagues, as I've indicated, we are running over time now. So I will not ask the panel to respond to these two questions today. what we will do is we will engage with all the participants in the webinar. We peaked at 169, which is really wonderful. To respond to these two questions about how Africa and Europe can work strategically together on research capacity for poverty reduction, and also if the dialogue continues, what are the key areas that would need to be explored? Two very important questions, I think, as well. We will, in the invitation to contribute to the post-webinar survey, also provide an opportunity for US participants to also raise any other issues that you would like to have followed up in a follow-up webinar meeting. I am presupposing that all the participants this morning will be available for a follow-up webinar. So apologies if I am speaking on your behalf, but I think it is important that we have this follow-up opportunity. Also to thank all the participants, I think, for very important perspectives today, which I think also helped us to understand the how we can view poverty alleviation, poverty mitigation, and resilience from multidimensional perspectives, and also from the perspectives of the continent and the region, countries, and specific institutions. We will then close our webinar with a final presentation by Professor Oyewole, the Secretary General of the African Association for Universities, on the launch of the African Research Innovation and Development Network. So, Professor Olusola, I hand over to you. Thank you.
We need to share my screen at this particular time. Thank you very much. Just a minute. Yes, thank you very much, Martin. I want to inform us that this is a pre-launch information on the African Research, Innovation, and Development Network that is about to take off from the Association of African Universities. One of the needs is that we need quality education for the development of Africa. And as part of this strategy, research is an essential tool for really driving African development. We believe that Africa needs research in order to become what it should be. And then for research to really be relevant, it must lead to innovation and contribute to development. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the observations of the EU-Africa Summit conversation is that we have found that it's true that some research are taking place in Africa, but many research in Africa do not lead to development. And the type of research we need in Africa now are the type of research that can drive the development of Africa. Therefore, universities in Africa need to be innovative. Universities in Africa need to ensure that their research outputs are developed beyond the classroom or the laboratories. And we want to start to see in Africa startup companies emanating from the researches being carried out in our African universities. It is our hope that universities should help Africa to convert the high potentials of our young people to creation of new jobs, especially startups within African institutions. This is the idea behind the concept of the African Research, Innovation, and Development Network. This network is about expanding and enhancing significantly the quality of research done in Africa by African researchers and empowering our researchers and universities to be focused on development. I believe that if we can do this, then the universities in Africa can meet the expectation of the African EU summit. What we are doing is this, ladies and gentlemen. The AFRIT network, which we are setting up, is bringing together a number of peer African institutions and researchers that are willing to work together with a view to generate a critical mass that could more effectively support development initiatives in the continent. As of the last count, we have about 2,805 higher education institutions in Africa. And the African Research, Innovation and Development Network is being led by the African Association of African Universities for Universities in Africa. I noticed that there are some similar or related initiatives that we've mentioned on this particular platform today. ARUA, for example, is made up of 16 universities. I can imagine research from 16 universities out of over 2,000. And our intention in AFRIT is to get the potentials, the research potentials of other universities beyond the field that we know now. We have the African Research Networks based in Manchester, the Forum for Innovation in African Universities, and the African Research and Impact Network. The plan that we have is that we want to prove that all universities in Africa can contribute to African development. Let me make a brief about the AFRIT initiative. The African Research, Innovation and Development in Network is a development platform for empowering African universities to employ research to contribute to development in the continent. It is anchored in the Association of African Universities, but it's going to be a grouping of higher education institutions in Africa with excellence in some areas, especially some of the areas that have been identified in the AU-EU discussions. We cannot do this alone, and that's why this AFRIT initiative is coming up with the international collaboration with the Obred Global, which is the organization really behind the AquaTube project. What are the goals, visions, and mission of the African Research Innovation Development Network? Our goal is to strengthen African universities and their capacity to undertake research for development. The big thing is not just any research, but research for development. Our vision is the promotion of African research for innovation and development. And our mission is the promotion of research networks among African universities for development. Very soon, ladies and gentlemen, we shall be creating opportunities for institutional registration, network of universities, and research teams in universities for them to join the networks of their choice. The focus of the research that we want to focus to look at for development in Africa will be on the following: agro-processing and food security, climate resonance and ocean, pharmacy and medical, entrepreneurship and social impact, artificial intelligence and remote systems, digitalization and ICT connection, social science and humanities for development, and lastly, innovations and startups. We believe that researchers and institutions across Africa will be able to key themselves to one of the niches that we've identified here. So if you're a researcher in African universities, or you're a university with a commitment to one or more of these research interests, we want you to get registered, and the call will be coming out very soon. Very soon, we are launching a call for research proposals. This network will also be promoting academic mobility of researchers that are involved in this network. We shall be supporting theses and training. There will be capacity building webinars within the networks. We shall also be promoting joint research proposals by members of the network. And we also hope to organize workshops and meetings for those that are involved in the network. As I mentioned earlier on, this is a pre-launching information session, and we hope that the call will be coming out from AAU within the next few weeks. Ladies and gentlemen, our intention is that the African Research, Innovation and Development Network will cover many universities in Africa. It will bring researchers together, and we shall promote research and academic excellence that will contribute to African development. Through this network, we want to prove to the African continent and to the African people that universities in Africa are not just interested in doing research for research's sake, but they are committed to research that will lead to the development of our continent. Thank you very much for this opportunity to make this pre-launch. I'm very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Prof. Olusola, for that important announcement, which I'm sure is something that the colleagues who are attending today will be very interested in, and I think it's something that you know would need to be discussed further going forward. I'm aware of the fact that we've gone slightly over time, but I think that it was important today to hear from all our speakers from the European Union, from the AAU, and then from the four panel members, Arua, Sarima, Malawi, Department of Science and Technology and Innovation, and also from UNICEF. I think that this is a conversation to be continued. I noticed that there was one remark that was made in the chat. This webinar is really speaking to the spirit of All Together for Better African Universities. And I believe that this is very much the spirit that we have today of working together. And perhaps one of the steps we need to take forward is how we can really build forward on our collaboration for better African universities. I think also that Prof. Olusola, I think you made a very important point, is that all universities on our continent have an important role to make to African development, and we need to really create an environment which recognizes the contribution of all universities on our continent to African development. So I think that's a very important point. And universities with different missions and visions will make different contributions, but all of them extremely important. So colleagues, thank you very much for your interest in today's webinar. I was very encouraged by the fact that we have ended off the webinar still with 172 participants in the webinar. That's really shows that people have stayed on, and I see many comments now saying that AFRID is a brilliant initiative. So I think congratulations to the AAU on having this vision for AFRID and for this contribution that all our universities on the African continent must make to continental development. So colleagues, I'm going to draw the webinar to a close now, but I just want to say, from my perspective, to be continued. It's a privilege as Sarua to be involved in this conversation. I look forward to taking this discussion forward and to really exploring how we can work together and come together around our shared challenges and so on. So I haven't consulted with Aubriel and the AAU and the EU yet on how this will be taken forward, but I'm sure that there will be a shared commitment to taking this this conversation forward, and to taking forward how we can really build on our relationships and the European Union. So thank you very much again. Thank you very much to all our speakers for your very valued contributions. The webinar recording will be available within a few days on the Albriol webinar site, which I know will be communicated to all of you who took part today. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. Bye-bye.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Martin.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.